Good evening. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. I have some stuff in here that I put together before the service. I'm going to try not to read a lot from it as so much as to speak about it. And also there's another thing that I want to share that is not so much related to this, but you know, lately I've been thinking a lot about giving, but it's not so much related to tithing as it is giving other things. And as I was looking at some scriptures, I found Deuteronomy 16, verse 17, say, every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God that has given you. So, a lot of people get caught up on the idea that when the Bible says that you have to give, that means that you have to give money all the time. And I don't necessarily agree with that, because that's not the only blessing that we get from God. We get other blessings as well. You know, James has been blessed with the gift of music. So his way of giving is by playing here during worship, you know. Others have been blessed, you know, with the gift of teaching, and those, the way of them giving is by taking the children, teaching the children about the Word of God and who God is and who Jesus is, you know. Then there's others that have been blessed financially and they're able to give that way. So I don't think we should get hung up on the idea that in God's eyes you're not giving if you cannot write a check or put a dollar in the offering. No, because there's so many blessings in the Bible, and as many blessings are in the Bible, those are the many number of ways that someone can give back. You know, Jesus said, for I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and gave you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brothers, you did it to me. So, you know, those words, you know, it's talking about these people gave of their food, they gave of their drinks, of their clothing, they gave their time, you know, to go visit someone. You know, just simply by giving a person a smile, you don't know the effect that a smile can have on that person. You're giving that person joy. You're sharing the joy that you have from the Lord. So, but also, now I'm going to look at this from the opposite side. And the Lord also tells us that we have to discern how we give. You know, we're commanded or encouraged to give, but there's people that try to take advantage of those that give. You know, people that refuse to take responsibility and want to live a careless life, you know, doing whatever they want, not being accountable for anything, as long as they can continue getting something out of others. But if you look in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul tells us that, for even when we were with you, this we command you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat. You know, we're put in situations or places in which we can be a blessing to others or to have others be a blessing to us. But if all we do is take and take and take and take, that blessing is not going to come, because we'll be acting out of selfishness. We won't be trusting God to provide for all of our needs. And then the same goes for the person that is taking advantage of us. Also, there's people that from the perspective of giving, they use the Lord as an excuse to not do what they're supposed to do. And I'm witnessing this firsthand, which is kind of why I'm talking about this. I believe wherever we are at a specific moment, we're there because God directed us there. And it's because either whoever we're with is going to be a blessing to us, or we're going to be a blessing to that person. So the decisions that we make in life are what are going to take us where we're supposed to go based on the Lord's plan and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We all have a calling, but negating to do something because the matters of the Lord are priority, that's an excuse. I'm not saying that we should not serve the God that we love and that provides for us. But I don't think that he's going to get mad at us or disappointed if we don't pray or worship for an hour because we have to do homework, or we have to be in a meeting and talk to other people. Yes, prayer is our intimacy with God, but he's not going to get mad if we don't do it 24/7. We're not praying when we're sleeping, unless our spirit is doing it and we're not aware of it. But I think that not doing what we're supposed to be doing in a specific situation because I have to do this because this is something that I have to do because it's a matter of the Lord. By not doing those things, we're not going to get prepared for the next step that we're supposed to take or the next place we're supposed to be in, because we're never going to get there. You know, if you're supposed to be, let's say you're a high school student and you're supposed to be in 5 years in this specific workplace because you're going to be a blessing to this person, if you don't pass school, you're not going to be there because you don't get hired, you know? So it also talks about taking from yours, from your family or your relatives. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8, it says, "But if any provide not for his own, and especially for those in his own house, he hath denied the faith and is worse than an infidel." So there's people that, I remember I was dating this girl when I was in high school, and I went to eat at her house one day. And I have this weird habit when I eat that I eat in order. I can have 3 different things on my plate and I don't mix them. First, I eat the vegetables. If I have piece of meat, potato, and some vegetables, I eat the vegetables, then the potato, then the meat. So I remember her dad asked me one time, "Oh, so you don't like the chicken?" "Yeah, I do." "So how come you're not eating it?" "Because I save it for last." And I said, "Well, when I was growing up, if someone came to our house to visit and there wasn't food for them, whoever had chicken on their plate, we took it out and gave it to the visitor." I said, "Well, I'm glad that everybody has some chicken on their plate." So, you know, just because we want to appear to be someone in front of other people, that's not what we're supposed to do. Because the family we have because the Lord gave them to us. So if we don't take care of our family, to take care of other people, how are we being good persons, you know? So hopefully that made sense. Then the next thing that I want to share is today, in addition to being Suzanne's birthday, happy birthday, by the way, it's also my nephew's birthday. He turns 15 today. And yeah, so maybe we should call him. So this last weekend, he started going to a Christian school this school year rather than a Catholic school like he was going before. And the school has one of the biggest churches in my hometown. So they had a retreat for all the kids in high school this past weekend. They stayed there from Friday to Sunday. So Sunday, during the church service, whoever wanted to testify could do it, but it was specifically the ones that participated in the retreat. So my mom was telling me that he got up and he went to the podium and he started speaking and he started saying all these things. But as I picture him in my mind, I could not believe, you know, the things that she was telling me that he was saying. And it's not in a bad way. But he was saying, you know, I know that the Lord got a hold of me this weekend and he dealt with all the things that I have been doing wrong. And he showed me what I'm supposed to do. So he said that Friday night, some people were going to gather to pray, and he felt that he needed to be part of that. So he was saying that all of the boys went, but all the girls stayed in their rooms. So he was praying, and as they were praying, he said that he heard the Lord tell him, you need to minister. So he said, okay, Lord, but who? I mean, who do you want me to talk to? He's like, don't worry about it. I'll give you the names. And Saturday, he talked to 8 kids there. They go to the same school as he does. But he says that as they talked, they all accepted the Lord as their Savior. And they were, you know, it was a really life-changing moment for all of them, even for him, too. Because one of those kids happens to be one of our neighbors back home. And this kid's mom, she's really into drugs. She's right now in, like, a rehab center trying to get better. His dad is always going out drinking. He leaves on Friday, doesn't come back until Monday morning. So he takes care of his little brother. Well, he got accepted into the school with a basketball scholarship. And they don't give those unless you are going to start playing as you get into 9th grade. He's in 11th grade. He's a junior. So as my nephew is telling this to the people in the church, he says, you know, when he accepted the Lord at that moment, that was a very happy moment for me, you know, seeing him do that and experience that. But if I was happy, how happy was God when that happened? So there's a celebration in heaven right now because another person is going, and my mom's telling me, and I'm just listening to her, and I'm driving, and I'm thinking, who's she talking about? Because it sounds like this very eloquent person. I'm not saying that my nephew is not eloquent enough, but he has somewhat of a speech impediment, and he gets really nervous talking in front of people and all that. But then my mom says that people were like screaming, amen, hallelujah, glory, clapping and all that, very excited, because she said it was a very, very spiritually intense moment when all these kids were talking. And she said that one of the leaders of the church approached my sister when they were done, and he said, you got a little pastor in there, so you better make sure that he makes it. But then they went home and the flesh took over. So let's keep them in our prayers that they be obedient and learn to let go of things in the world. So whatever God is doing in their lives has the opportunity to come to pass, and whatever it is that needs to be revealed. So that's my little story. Anyone wants to share anything, a prayer request? Sorry it took so long. James. Put your needs before the Lord and He will provide. Anyone else?
My brother David.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
The story of your, it was your nephew?
Mm-hmm.
I was not embarrassed of God, but I was just, the young people today, I pray that God gets a hold of them in such a way that they don't have to unlearn all the religion that a lot of us have grown up with, and that He fulfills everything in their life that He wants to, because they do have the boldness and a love that even when I was in school didn't exist.
I don't know about you, but to me, I know that God's talking to me, because it's not like just some random thought that comes to mind or like a keyword here and there. It's like a full sentence, sometimes a few. And when that happens, my instant reaction is to stop, because I know something's happening, and I'm like, okay, hold on, I'm not imagining this. And I pay attention to what's happening, and whatever it is said to me, it might not be for me, but I get this feeling inside of me that if I don't say whatever it is, I'm preventing something from happening. That's to me kind of like how I know what I get is because God's talking to me. Yes.
Jew was ready.
they don't know it, they can't acknowledge it. If somebody doesn't show that to them, other than just showing them, look, I'm spiritual, you're a slug, you know, you're a jerk, and so we don't want to mess with you because you're unclean or whatever, kind of the way the church has been in a lot of ways, except when they're on a evangelistic jag, you know. But the rest of the time, everybody else is off limits, and they're unclean, and we're, you know. But the truth is, Jesus made a sacrifice that covers every living, to live, has lived human being. That's what he did. And he did it out of love. So, you know, our responsibility is to love people, is to love others. I don't mean smarmy, you know, the kind of, you know what I mean, not the level you live in and all that kind of stuff. I mean, that's fine, that's your personality, but I mean, just to be a friend, to reach out to him. And that's what you're saying with the, when Jesus said, look, when you fed me, you clothed me, you gave me to drink, you visited me when I was in prison. Every time you do that, it doesn't mean just to another person that's in the church, but to anybody, everybody. That's the whole point. So, you know, there's a lot more people saved than we understand, than we acknowledge. Because even people that are going to church, even people that have made a profession of faith and have some theological understanding of that, even a lot of them, just like you're saying with your nephew, he goes back home and
flesh the
business as usual. But it doesn't undo what he's done.
Mm-hmm.
But it can cause us to think less of him.
Mm-hmm.
And where Jesus is pleased with the kid.
Yeah.
You know, he couldn't be happier. This is what you're born again for, you know. And it isn't that going back home and acting stupid is good, but it doesn't change his spiritual identity. He's still the righteousness of God in Christ. And that's what people don't understand. They're measuring everything by this roller coaster ride that we call life. And we're all of us have ups and downs. Some of us have learned the religious way of dealing with it. We've learned how to not be dysfunctional in public or whatever. But the truth is, God's not dealing with what we're doing on the outside. Anyhow, he's dealing with the heart.
Yeah.
So he knows when I want to call somebody that name and just don't because it's not correct.
Mm-hmm.
It's not socially acceptable or whatever. But it doesn't change the fact that I've already said it as far as God's concerned.
Mm-hmm.
My heart has already expressed that feeling. So, but he doesn't judge me by that. I'm still saved. I'm still righteous. I'm still everything that he's declared me to be in Christ. So that's what people need to know. Young people especially, I think before they get a chance to be put on the masks, you know, they're still able to, they're amongst the friends, they can just be themselves, and they're accepted that way. And that's what God says when he wants us to come as little children. Without the facade, you know, without the mask of righteous self-righteousness or anything else. So, you know, when we project that message that, you know, God does love you, that's not just a cliche. It's not just something we say because we're Christians. God really does love you in the midst of all of this chaos that looks like hell on earth in your life. God still loves you. He still sees you as worth the sacrifice, you know. And so that, I think, is what this is all about, what life is really all about. It's not about being quote-unquote religion and trying to get people to join our team, but to release the love of God into their lives so that they can, through that, they can develop all the things that you're talking about here today. That's the only way it's going to happen. I mean, it's not going to happen by self-discipline and what the Bible calls will worship. You know, it just won't work. That won't work. They'll get burned out. They'll get frustrated. Because deep in his heart, I'm sure your nephew probably has got a bunch of guilt that he's dealing with now. Because he knows he did the one thing. Now it looks like a hypocrite.
Mm-hmm.
But which is the hypocrite?
No.
See, I mean, the hypocrite is the guy, the nephew, who feels like he worthy now because he did something bad. That's the hypocrite. A hypocrite is somebody who's pretending to be something that he's not. Well, he's the righteousness of God in Christ. He's not what he pretended to be when he went home. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
The outward thing that matches his inward man,
yep,
the reality is what your mother saw and related to you at the retreat. The hypocritical part of him is the part that comes home and doesn't match that.
Mm-hmm.
And then it feels guilty and ashamed and all that kind of stuff. And that's what keeps people from going on in their relationship with God and developing it, because they think, now he's mad, he's rejecting me now, he should, because I've been a real jerk. You know? And so they either put up this tough outer shell that says, I don't care and I don't need God, and blah, 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 just to kind of cover their behavior, or they just run off and hide.
Yes, Sally.
Sense out of it, some chronological, linear way of doing things, but the truth is, it's all done.
Exactly.
I mean, it's already done. People just acknowledge, and how they acknowledge it, we know eventually it comes from, you know, the heart, the mouth, speech, but is it for me? I mean, does he have to say it to me? You know, the declaration is to God.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what I'm saying? We make these we rededicate them, all the, which is but it's not a rededication as far as God's concerned.
Mm-hmm.
There's a one time forever, and it's done. Now we have to deal with our
ups and downs
and failures and weaknesses and so forth, and so that's why we do it. That's why we rededicate. That's why we, and there's nothing wrong with it. I'm just saying, you're either believing what has already done, been done, or you're not.
Exactly.
And so if a person ever makes the feeblest of commitments, it's permanent. Now how they express that afterwards will vary, you know, by huge amounts depending on the person, the circumstances, and everything else. But that's because some people are immediately respond to the Spirit, yield to the Spirit, where others are still trying to rationalize everything and do it through the natural way, partly depending on how they're taught, the church they go to, their circumstances, and everything else. And so, you can stand them side by side, and in the eyes of God, they look identical.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what we forget, because we have to deal so much with the flesh, with the natural man, with the external things, you know, that everything about God is internal, everything about God is invisible and spiritual, and that's how he deals with it. He doesn't deal with our flesh. He's not mad at our flesh. He just doesn't deal with it. It's temporary. Mm-hmm. It's like everything else on this planet. Mm-hmm. It'll go away of all things at some point.
Mm-hmm.
But the Spirit will live forever.
Amen.
So these people, these are spirit beings, mm-hmm, that belong to God. And all we're doing is trying to somehow help them to reconnect. That's all we do. And how we do it doesn't matter. I mean, there isn't a way or a right way or a wrong way. Whatever way works is the one that's right. And we all know this. You can have, that's the problem with religion. It wants to box everything and give you 3 steps to how to do it. And then we try to do that with everybody. And to one person, they're totally offended. The next person, they love you and embrace it and are weeping on your shoulder. The other one wants to punch your face, you know, because they're different people. You know, so that's why we have the Spirit to lead us to deal with individuals. There's just not a carte blanche, if you will, way of dealing with them. They have personalities. They have histories. They have past. They have all of these other things that you can't just hand somebody a book and say, this is how you do it. Go get them. You know? We know that doesn't work because that's what the church has been doing for a long time. And it's created a lot of hypocrites, a lot of people that are ashamed, miserable, and forces them to become hypocrites so they can be accepted within that group. You know? Anyway.
All right, let's stand.
Oh. And by the way, talk about giving drinks. I bought rounds of drinks a lot of times, so I'm really in good shape with God, I'm sure. I don't know how many drinks I've bought him over the years. He knows.
So yeah. You're good.
Oh. You'll never hear that from some drunk one day. And
yeah.
Say, you know?
Yeah. Oh. Well, let's thank the Lord for being good. Father, we thank you for loving us the way you do, Lord. We know, Father, that you have loved us even before we were born into this world, because our spirits are yours, Father, before the foundation of this world, Lord. We thank you, Father, for choosing us to do your will. Father, for showing others who you are, for your light to shine through us, Lord, for giving us your love, for giving us your only Son to die for our sins. That's how much you love us, Lord. We thank you, Father, for all of those that are coming back to you, because we know, Father, that you are going to transform their lives. We thank you, Father, for those that have not come to you yet, because we know that they will answer your calling. They will hear your calling, Father, whether it's directly from you or from you through someone else. But we know, Father, that you're calling all of your children. reconciled for all of us to know and see and understand who it is that you are, Father. Everything that you do, Father, is because of your goodness, Lord. Glorify you, Lord. We magnify you. We give you thanks for manifesting yourself in our lives, for giving us your spirit, for making us your righteousness. Tom Stammen will be here Friday, October 24th, if you're able to make it. Okay, we'll speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Thank you, Lord. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
John, would you mind taking the offering? He's like, pick me, pick me.
Okay. Let's have a thanks and a giving.
Worship.
You know, I was thinking this morning that sometimes we are like a dam, and God is trying to do something, but we're holding him back. And he says, I'm going to take care of you. We're like, okay, take care of this. I'll take care of this. No. I'm going to take care of you. Yeah, that's fine. Take care of this. I'll take care of this. No. So when we do that, we're just opening the dam just a little bit, and it's like a trickle of God that's coming through. No, we just got to open the whole gate and let it come and flood our lives.
Open wide the
gates. I was thinking about that.
Open wide the gates.
Yeah.
Yes. Let the King of glory come in.
Thank you. You're the one. God. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you tonight, Lord. We bless you and praise you. Thank you, Lord, for your multiple acts of kindness and love. For your goodness, Lord, that endures forever. We bless you tonight. We bless the name of Jesus. And praise that name above all names. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thanks, everybody, for your sharing tonight. Thanks to the worship team for leading us into the tangible presence of the Lord. Praise God. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. God is, Tom Stammons always saying, God is good and the devil's bad. God's good all the time, devil's bad all the time. That is so true, though, that God is good. God's never in a bad mood. He's not angry. And we have these kind of mixed ideas about how, like, God's mood changes from day to day the way ours do from time to time. But the truth is, God's is love. Period. And I just want to show you a few things in the scripture tonight that I think sometimes, over the years at least, I have had some conflicting ideas about how God showed his anger at sin through Jesus, but that's not really the case. In fact, even where it says, I was just before church, I was looking up some of the scriptures on wrath, and actually the word that's used the majority of the time in the New Testament, especially with only one or two exceptions, that is the word orge, not orgy, but orge. It's a Greek word, but it just means strong passion. It doesn't, I mean, it can then be used, you know, it's like any word that you can use, use it to express anger, but you could also use it to express love. It's just a strong, passionate emotion. And so sometimes where God was pouring out wrath, you know, quote unquote, it is judgment. But most of the time it's just strong emotion. It's just love. It's passion. And, you know, when it talks about, in Psalms, I think it's 92, it says, my God, why? It's a prophetic word. And then you look in the Gospels and you see it literally plays out almost word for word. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? I look and all my bones are out of joint and all that. The truth is, God didn't forsake Jesus on the cross. It just felt like it to Jesus. Amen? In the midst of all of that, God was with him. God never left him. How could he? He was God in the flesh. Right? We have these ideas that God was mad at Jesus because of the sin for that moment. And so he forsook him. But that's absolutely incorrect. It's just bad theology. So, I guess what I'm saying in a roundabout way, and I'll get to it a little bit in more detail here, is that it isn't when when we sin, God doesn't stop loving us. Quote unquote, whatever you want to call sin. Because Jesus had the sins of the entire world, past, present, and future, and God still didn't forsake him. If he had, there would have been no resurrection. Praise the Lord. So, you know, we need to change some of our concepts and our way of thinking about things in order to do the very things that we were talking about here tonight. To be the influence, the God influence that we are supposed to be, we need to have a better understanding of our relationship with God so that we can then portray that to others. Because I've said it many times, but I'm going to just say it one more time here. Our concept of God or our perception of God determines our presentation of God. So if we think God is angry and he's mad and he's going to do these bad things and stuff, then that's the projection that we put out there. That's what we portray to other people. Well, I got to tell you, most people that are quote-unquote sinners already got problems. They're reaping the results of their sin already. All they really need now is for you to tell them that God's going to get them too. Amen? God's not getting them because they sin. He's already dealt with the sin issue. Their sin, be sure your sin will find you out. Doesn't mean that it's going to search around and catch you. It means that whatever you reap or sow, you're going to reap.
Exactly.
Yeah. You know, choices have consequences. Amen?
Amen?
The good news is, as a believer, all things can work together for good, even your bad choices.
Exactly.
For an unbeliever, they're just stuck with the choices. They're stuck with the consequences. And sadly, a lot of believers, because they don't believe that God will work it out for good, then they end up reaping the negative. Praise the Lord. Oh, okay, let's move. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 8. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 1 John 4, 7 through 8. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Not for God loves a lot of things, or God loves a bunch, or God, but God is love. I mean, that is more profound than I can even begin to get my head around, let alone try to express it to somebody else. For us, it's an attribute. It's a, you know, it's a character issue. It's all these things. With God, it's just who he is. You cannot separate him from love. Now, that ought to change our entire concept of God. That ought to change our whole way of thinking about God and our relationship with him. Religion has done so much to abuse that truth. And I mean not to take advantage of, but to twist it to a place where it is just an emotion with God. That sometimes he loves you, and then when you're bad, he gets you. But that's not God. God is love. All the time he's love. Period.
Yes.
So whatever God is doing, he's doing it out of love. He can't be doing it with any other motive. It would be impossible, right? Okay, now let's go to Leviticus chapter 16 and verses 7 through 10. 16. Leviticus 16, verses 7 through 10. And he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. Praise the Lord. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell and offer him for a sin offering.
But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. Now drop down, stay in the same chapter, but drop down to verse 20 and we'll read verses 20 through 22. And when he hath made an end of reconciling the holy place and the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar, he shall bring the live goat, and Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions in all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. Praise the Lord. So, scapegoat. We all understand that in our language, in our the way we would use it. It's somebody who takes the blame for what somebody else did. And we use them as a scapegoat, right? Well, in the sacrificial system that we're reading here in Leviticus, it did exactly that. That's exactly what the scapegoat was all about. Amen? And it's an obvious picture of Jesus and what Jesus would do then with the sins of all of man, all of humanity. Amen. So the question is, was the goat punished in anger? Was there, you know, was that high priest? No. There was no anger at all. Amen. The goat wasn't punished by an angry priest. It simply took the sins of the people on itself and carried those sins away. And that's exactly what Jesus did for us. Look at Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 26. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now, once in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Right? So just in the same way that Aaron wasn't angry when he laid his hands on the head of the goat, neither was our Heavenly Father angry when Jesus took away the sins of the world. God was not mad. Praise the Lord. Let's go back to Leviticus again, this time chapter 5 and verses 5 through 13. And I'll show you what I mean. Now, I don't know about anybody else. Maybe this is nothing. Maybe everybody else has gotten way past this. But to me, I'm thinking that was like the angriest God had ever been. But it's not true. God was not angry. Now, this is back to Leviticus chapter 5. And it shall be when he shall be guilty in one of these things that he shall confess that he hath sinned in that thing, and he shall bring his trespass offering unto the Lord for his sin, which he hath sinned. A female from the flock, a lamb or a kid of the goats for a sin offering, and the priest shall make an atonement for him concerning his sins, for his sin. And if he be not able to bring a lamb, in other words, if he doesn't have the money, if he's not doesn't have the resources, then this kind of goes to what Roberto was talking about. Then he shall bring for his trespass, which he hath committed, two turtle doves, or two young pigeons unto the Lord, one for a sin offering, and the other for a burnt offering. And he shall bring them unto the priest, who shall offer that which is for the sin offering first, and wring off his head from his neck, but shall not divide it asunder. And he shall sprinkle of the blood of the sin offering upon the side of the altar, and the rest of the blood shall be wrung out at the bottom of the altar. It's a sin offering. And he shall offer the second for a burnt offering according to the manner, and the priest shall make an atonement for him for his sin, which he hath sinned, and it shall be forgiven him. But if he be not able to bring two turtle doves or two young pigeons, so if he don't even have the money for that, then he that sins shall bring forth his offering the tenth part of an ephah of fine flour for a sin offering. He shall put no oil upon it, neither shall put any frankincense thereon, for it is a sin offering. Then shall he bring it to the priest, and the priest shall take his handful of it, even a memorial thereof, and burn it on the altar according to the offerings made by fire unto the Lord. It is a sin offering. Now, here's the question. If this is about anger, how do you get angry at a bag of flour? Praise the Lord. I mean, you can hate birds, maybe have a thing about goats and sheep and get angry and upset or whatever, but I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Flour? Praise the Lord. God is love. Period. Now, let's look at Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Be ye therefore followers of God. That word actually translates imitators. That's the truest translation. So be ye therefore imitators of God as dear children and walk in love. Right? Because God is love. As Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. Praise the Lord. So Jesus' sacrifice, according to that scripture and everything else, and when you bring it into context, was actually not some horrible thing in the sight of God. It was a sweet-smelling savor. It was something beautiful that God saw. As hideous as it might have looked in the natural, to God it was something beautiful. It was a sweet savor. Amen? It brought joy to the Father. Praise the Lord. Let's look at Psalms 32, verse 1. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. That word, the root word there for forgive is nasa, N-A-S-A, and it means taken away. So when you see the word forgive or forgiven, it literally in the Hebrew would mean take away. Right? All right, look at chapter 2 and verse 12. 1 John 2 and 12. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. The tense of that verb is continuous. It means the result is going to be ongoing. So he's constantly taking away our sins. It never ends. It's an ongoing thing. Our sins have been forgiven. They have been sent away. Amen? In the New Testament Greek, that forgive is translated charizomai, which is the root word for that is charis, which is grace. So, it's used 19 times in the New Testament, and it denotes an action of doing something pleasant, something gracious, and something benevolent toward another person. So when we see what Jesus did, it's an act of benevolence. It's an act of love that brings joy to God. As hideous as it was in the natural, this is something beautiful in the eyes of God. Why? Because he loves us. And it's the only way to reconcile us, to bring the lost back. So it's a beautiful thing to God. It's an expression of God's love. As hard as that it might seem to be for people to see the passion of Christ and get the impression that God is so angry that all this has to be done to... No, God loves and sees this as an act of love. Not meanness, not wrath, as we've been led to believe. Amen? Jesus' death was the source of forgiveness, amen, for our sin. But at the crucifixion, God wasn't pouring out his anger on Jesus in order to satisfy his wrath. Divine forgiveness is the gracious act of sending our sins away from us and never associating them with us again. Now, as I said, yeah, there's punishment for sin, but it doesn't come from pure love. It doesn't come from God. Sin brings its own punishment. Period. That's the beauty of having been born again. Even the punishment for the sin that we commit now, God turns it to good. That's love. You cannot tell me God is love, pure love, and then try to contradict that with this wrath of God. I believe this is true. The book of Revelation talks about, you know, the judgments and so on and so forth. I don't believe it's God. I believe it's just man reaps what he sows. When God takes that which restrains away, which is his spirit and his believers here on earth, then the result is just what would naturally happen and would have already happened thousands of years ago if there wasn't the church here. Amen? But we read it and we see that as this angry God. Look, God isn't angry. You know, well, he's angry at sin. No, he's not. He's already dealt with sin. If anything, God loves, and we know that he does, he loves the whole world. He's not going to do this. This is going to be the result of the evil that's here. It's people say, well, you know, God's judging. God is not judging. God has already judged. Period. The result of what happens after the Spirit of God has been removed or the church has been removed out of here is just the natural result of unbridled sin. I mean, look around and see what's going on right now in the world with the church here. Imagine there is no grace anymore. We don't know what hideous is. We don't know what horror is. So if Revelation is depicting that, it's not depicting something coming from God. God would be schizophrenic to the, you know, squared. You know, I mean, it wouldn't make any sense. And that's why I said, the more grace you understand, the greater revelation you have of God. Because there was a time I'd have argued this with you. But now, just common sense tells me that doesn't work. That can't be right. We just do not comprehend this massive, endless outpouring of God's love for us. It's unlimited. There is no limits, no bounds to it. If we ever understand it, God help us to understand it before our lives are over so that we can enjoy the benefits of it. God loves you so much, he doesn't want you to lack anything in any area of life. Nothing, anywhere. The reason we don't see the degree of manifestation that we should is because we have a limited understanding of God's love. If I just heard somebody saying this, I don't know, today or whenever, but the reason we're not comfortable with God is because we don't think God really loves us as much as we need to be loved. The reason we don't feel that is because we're not honest. You know, we say, yes, you know, I still do things that probably are not, quote unquote, perfect Christian behavior. So therefore, God is probably not pleased with me in that area. absolutely untrue. No, no relationship can be complete unless the people in the relationship are totally honest with each other. In other words, if you pretend to not be okay, you pretend you don't have a temper, but you can only pretend that until you get angry, right? And then your temper shows up. But because you never showed that anger before in this relationship, you convince the other person that you don't have a temper. Now they find out you do have a temper, and so you're not secure anymore. You don't feel secure in that relationship because now you've been exposed. A part of you that you didn't want them to see, they didn't bargain for, right? So now you're insecure in the relationship because they may not love me now that they know this about me, right? And it can be anything, and everybody's got something, right? But you see, that's how we relate to God in so many ways. The truth is, though, God knows everything and knew everything before you ever made the first feeble attempt to even acknowledge him. He had already accepted you. That's why you can have the security in this relationship. That's why you can expect that God's going to do good things for you even when you're not good, because he already knew it and still said, I love you. The ultimate love, I have it for you, and it's not ever going to change. So every time, you know, we're taught something on the order of these things that I've spoken a little bit about tonight, the more we reinforce this idea that under this love, just simmering there, is this hostile, angry God that's just waiting to blow up if we put enough pressure on him. When in fact, that's a total impossibility.
Yeah.
It just won't happen. God is love all the time. Completely. He loves the person that's out there doing things who don't even know God, who don't acknowledge God. He loves them, and he's not punishing them for their sin. Their sin has its own consequences. Praise the Lord. And he's willing to redeem them even from those consequences. Because he is love. Say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Glory to God. Give him a hand clap. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I kept my word. God bless you. Go in the love of the Lord. Enjoy it. Be happy. Don't worry. Be happy. Right? I mean, think about it. What have we got to worry about? We've got the God of the universe, creator of everything. And his love is without limit for us, for each of us individually. Can't get any better than that. It'll take and all through eternity. That's what we're going to be finding out more about. Is more of God's love. Greater and greater and greater. Praise the Lord. God bless everybody. Amen. Have a good remainder of your week, and come on back Sunday. Let's praise the Lord. I say the best.